Hey everybody, this is Alan Arnette with another video interview, and I'm really excited to have Mark Gunlogson here. And that Icelandic name is a little bit hard to get out my mouth, but what I'm really excited about, Mark, is Mountain Madness has this incredible history. Of course, starting with Scott Fisher back in 1984. Is that right?
Yep, 1984.
Yeah. When he started the company, and of course you took it over in the early 2000s, and you're the current CEO, president, and run the place out of Seattle, along with lots of other great employees like Steve and others for Mountain Madness. I think that people, when they hear about Mountain Madness, they have a lot of different ideas about what it is. So first off, let's just talk about the company itself, and then we're going to get into the Everest season and what's happening there. You've made a very serious decision not to go to Nepal this spring, and we want to get into that. And also, you have a very interesting fundraiser to help the Sherpa community. But I know you're also active with your staff and support teams from Kilimanjaro to Ecuador, all around the world. But let's start with you, Mark. Tell us a little bit about you. What kind of a climber are you? What do you consider yourself to be? Everybody's a climber, right?
Well, you know what? When I've been watching this stuff going on in K2, the winter since, and I mean, it's unfortunately not ending so great, but the cold temperatures they have endured and that sort of thing, that sort of thing just doesn't appeal to me anymore. I've had my time in the cold environments, and I would say now I consider myself a warm weather, fair weather rock climber. And that suits me just fine.
That sounds safer.
It's safer and it's warmer, so it's all good. And I really enjoy that. So that's been my thing sort of all along. But I've been climbing. Took my first climbing course when I was 15 years old, back in the Cascades and out of Seattle. And just been, been able to get all over the world with climbing and guiding, and ended up here with sort of more of an office job than climbing, which is actually fine. I'm okay with that. But it's been an interesting journey with Mountain Madness, for sure.
When did you actually start with Mountain Madness? What year?
It was about 94. So I was there when Scott was around, and that was interesting and good times. And then, of course, 96 with Into Thin Air event, things change, and Christine Boskoff stepped in, and she had her run with the company, and unfortunately also perished. So I've been there with the company for 26 years now.
So you've kind of been the glue that's held Mountain Madness together through all of these events in history.
I guess you could say that. And it's been great, because I came to the company with 7 years of guiding under my belt already. So it's kind of perfect to be able to bring those connections and skills and knowledge to Mountain Madness.
So do you have a favorite area of the world to explore? And also the second part of that, a favorite mountain that you climbed?
Oh, geez. That's almost an impossible question to answer. But, it's all good. I mean, one of the things, having climbed all over the world for decades, it's kind of nice to come back to the Cascades and sort of my home turf and where I've started climbing. So that, to me, that's like my, best place. It's my home. Of course, I like to go to the desert and do some desert rock climbing, but it's all good. I mean, there's places there that have the interesting culture and the mountains and the whole deal. So it's hard to pin that one down.
I think that your love of rock climbing must influence the selection of guides, because I know that your Ecuadorian group, like Ozzy, and gosh, when those guys, I mean, they just, Ozzy built a climbing wall in his house on the outside of his house. So just, these guys are just, they love climbing on rock. I mean, they're just.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's the physical part of the sport, right? So and that's why it has a lot of appeal for people. It's more to technical, physical aspect versus, one step after another in mountaineering. And I think it's appealing for obvious reasons, I think.
So speaking of Ozzy and Steve, and so with this COVID going on, still going on a year later, how's the Mountain Madness family doing relative to, not only the virus itself, but also, the lack of business and, you know, just all the challenges that the, especially the guiding community and the tourist business
has. Yeah. Oh yeah. Well, you know, fortunately I would consider myself somewhat of a conservative business person. And so we had a rainy day fund.
Good.
And a lot of people, you know, we're dipping into that, and that's, you know, what it's for. And it's very useful when you have it. And so, so we definitely got, you know, we're dipping into that. But you know, I mean, who would have thought it's almost a year now, right? I think when it started up, the COVID thing last February, March,
right?
We all thought, oh, it might go for 2-3 months and things will get back to normal or better. And of course, here we are. So, so the first, as with everybody, any business, the first part of the dealing with the pandemic from a business standpoint was really difficult. And I thought, well, you know, I'm going to have some free time now. That's okay. We'll just ride it out. But we got so involved with trying to manage things and cut corners and save money and the sacrifices of people that work here have made, not only from the office staff to, you know, our guides overseas and whatnot. So everyone's made sacrifices and we've gotten through it. And now, like this year, we've had a great winter season here in Cascades. So our avalanche education programs is cranking. We're actually, we've booked the entire season, which is great. And our backcountry ski program's growing. And so we're gonna get through it. And you know, not having Aconcagua and the Nepal season, of course, now, you know, it's gonna have a blow, but we're thinking, you know, 2 or 3 more months, and I think we'll be back on track. So we're hanging in there. We're good. So
do you think that Rainier and Denali will be open in 21?
It seems like that's a word we're getting. I mean, that things could change, but seems like things are going in the right direction.
That's great.
We're not done yet, but yeah, it's going the right way.
So it sounds like, though, that you've also made a pretty strategic decision about going to Nepal. You were considering an Everest trip this spring, and also you already had some base camp treks and some other, you know, expeditions planned. But I understand that you've made a decision to cancel those for 2021. Kind of walk us behind that decision and why you made it.
Yeah, well, it wasn't an easy decision, especially with the Aconcagua season canceled, and then a lot of the our Kilimanjaro trips got canceled. So we were kind of looking forward to the Nepal season happening, and that was going to be what got us through the early spring. But you know, it was one of those things where when we started looking at the risks, and you know, it kind of became a risk management question, not so much about like, oh, we're on the mountain and we have to manage ice fall or something like that. It's more about people. And so we thought that, I mean, the impacts in this case, not only about our guests or our clients, but it's about all the people surrounding us in Nepal. And so we decided the impact could potentially be too big and on a larger scale. We have not had this kind of risk management question before. Like, how do we deal with this? Well, you stay home. And we do our part in keeping the thing from getting worse and having people bring it there or get it from people in Nepal. So yeah, it's all about people and people's welfare that drove the decision.
So I'm sure that your staff in Kathmandu and elsewhere in Nepal they were disappointed with this. How did they take it?
Well, some of them are still going to get work. As you know, the climbing season, is still happening, and there's going to be some work for some of them. Others, I mean, that's the thing. It's like the flip side of this whole decision is that, you know, there's people that are hurting economically in a big way. And so it was really difficult to make these decisions. And I think hopefully some of them will pick up work and they'll stay healthy, and we have a fundraiser going to maybe help them out a little bit. And so, you know, I hope they can get through it. Excuse me for a sec. Hopefully they can get through it. And you know, we'll have a really good fall season.
It's good to see the phone still ringing in the office.
Yeah.
So you mentioned the fundraiser. Let's go there. You know, you've made this announcement. It's on your website. It came out in your newsletter that you're doing a pretty innovative fundraiser, which involves matching funds from Mountain Madness as a company. So tell us about that and tell us how we can help.
Yeah, well, I mean, we're trying to, it's more we're trying to get people to do a matching fund with us. So we're doing our part raising money, and we're encouraging people. There's some nonprofits we're working with that might match what we raise. So we're not officially doing a matching fund, Mount Madness, but we have people that are going to do that with us, hopefully. So, but basically what we're doing is we're going to try to help out some of our staff. So we have a goal of $20,000. So it's a place to start. And we're also going to help out however we can with the vaccination process in the Khumbu, or wherever it turns out to be most needed in Nepal. But that's where our main focus is. And we don't have, we're going to figure out an organization to work with because it hasn't actually started up there yet. And who knows when it will. But we're just, you know, we're going to insert ourselves however we can be most impactful and along the supply chain and the process of getting the vaccinations up in the mountains.
Cool. I mean, yeah, that's, I think that India provided 1 million doses for
that's
for
right. Nepal.
But Nepal has a population of 29 million and you know, in remote places like, you know, Annapurna or the Manaslu area, and certainly the Khumbu, they may be the last to get this. So I think that efforts like yours to help, you know, get that vaccination to those really remote places through the other, through NGOs is just a really, really lauded. That's just outstanding.
It's small contribution maybe, but I think if you get enough collective energy behind the idea, and you know, you get a lot of people making small donations, it all adds up. And that's kind of the hope. You know, it's just to sort of get it out there. And it's like, hey, let's do this together and see what we can come up with.
Maybe some of the other guide companies around the globe will join you in this effort.
Yeah. The travel industry as a whole, it doesn't have to be mountain guide, it's the travel industry as a whole, because the places that we go, you know, they've been hugely impacted by this. And I think anything that the industry can do to help is going to be beneficial for everybody.
We talk about Nepal a lot, but also you're very active in on Kilimanjaro with you know, and Steve was telling me the other day that your local guys that run the Kili trips are just, I mean, they are second to none.
Yeah.
Just talk briefly about Kili and your program there.
Oh yeah. Well, so that's actually our oldest program, really. Scott Fisher and Wes Krause started Mount Madness together in 84. And Wes Krause decided, they did some trips in the Cascade. They were doing things on Kilimanjaro, and Wes decided to stay in Africa.
Oh.
And so so over the years, over the decades, I should say, you know, he got to know the place better than anybody. Local connections are, you know, second to none. So, you know, our program there is amazing, and it's got, you know, more than 30 years of history behind it. The staff is great. We use all local Tanzanian guides and porters and the whole work. So yeah, it's great.
And similar to South America as well. I've, gone with you guys to Ecuador and to Bolivia. Mm-hmm. And I'll tell you, I mean, not a paid endorsement, but I am just completely impressed with your, you know, with Ozzy and the whole crew in South America.
Yeah.
Talk a little bit about that program.
Well, you know, at that program, I mean, it kind of reflects Mount Madness as a whole, because one of the things that when I started at Mount Madness, I'd come from some other companies that had bigger permits. They had the, you know, Rainier and Denali permits. And it's really hard as a small company to compete with that. So I'm like, okay, I know what those clients and those companies were experiencing. So I took what I heard of their complaints. I say, hey, let's build on that, right? So it's kind of became more of a customer service driven company. And I think customer service and also services. So and Ecuador is a great example. You know, we track down the best guides, we track down the best places to stay, the best places to eat. So it's all about service and just making it a higher quality experience, really.
You know, but also you offer, I think, just a phenomenal value. I know that my trip to Ecuador, the places that we stayed in, like you, to your point about the food, oh my gosh, I felt guilty half the time. So I'm supposed to be, you know, sleeping on the ground in a tent.
Yeah.
not staying in this incredible hacienda and having this amazing food.
Yeah, no, we call them eating expeditions. So, climbing second. So
yeah, I normally lose weight, but I gained weight when I went.
No, but you know, that's the thing. It's like that. I mean, yeah, it is an incredible deal. And if we were able to charge what maybe a higher end company would charge for something like that, our price would be quite higher. But we're, you know, and it's very competitive business. So we keep the price down, and we try to get more people to sort of, you know, join the madness and then keep coming back and back every year and enjoying the services.
You have a lot of repeat customers, don't you?
We do. Yeah. No, we're trying to, you know, the whole idea is a community, and, you know, it's like the guides get to know the guests and they become friends, and it's like, hey, let's do a trip next year. And, you know, so they just keep coming back, and that's the best business you can have, really.
Yeah. I mean, word of mouth is absolutely the best endorsement possible. Yeah. Do you have any areas around the world that you're exploring to go to that you haven't run?
Well, you know, we used to do Pakistan quite a bit. And I think that obviously got backburnered for a while there because of politics, but we're going back to the K2 base camp. We're going to do a trek. I hope to go on that. We were supposed to go last summer, which obviously didn't happen, but we're hoping to go this summer. I don't know. It's just like, there's always something. We're doing more skiing, which is something we've been trying to break into over the years. And we've just always been branded as a climbing company, and that's it. But we're doing a lot more skiing. Which is great. And let's see, what else are we doing? Oh, well, you know, we've always been talking about the Venezuela tapuis, but that's not exactly a great place to go right now. So, yeah. But then, the other one that we're really excited about is in Colombia. I did a recon trip with one of our guides down there in the Santa Marta's mountains. And it's, there's peaks there that are hardly ever climbed, and amazing place. But there's some villagers, the Kogi tribes people, they're very restrictive about access to the sacred peak. And so we've been able to get permission from them.
Wow.
And so we're just trying to get a trip going now. So
is that like a jungle environment, I assume?
Oh yeah. No, I mean, it's incredible. It's like, you start in tropical forest. Well, actually you start down, if you want, you can start in the Caribbean and in the beach. So you get your feet wet in the sand and then you go swimming, and then you go hike through the jungle, and then you get up in the alpine zone, and it's just an incredible place.
That sounds fantastic. You talk about going to Pakistan. I'll tell you what, I've been there now twice, once for Broad Peak and once for K2. And that trek along the Baltero Glacier is, I mean, you know, I fell in love with mountaineering. I did a trek to Everest Base Camp back in 1997, seeing the scale of the mountains and the beauty of the Himalayas and Nepal. But I was absolutely gobsmacked when I began walking on the Baltero and seeing, Nameless Towers and Trango and Gashurbrum 4 right there north of Concordia. And then looking to my left and seeing K2. I mean, the scale of the mountains along that trek just leave you I've got to say for people is buy the largest memory chip you can for your camera.
The place just seems magical and sort of unimaginable. I mean, not possible is the stuff is of that scale. And I'm really looking forward to getting there.
And the people were incredibly welcoming. I always felt safe. They were just very accommodating. And, even though it's an area of conflict, I just felt as an American just so safe there and really grateful to the Pakistani people.
Well, I've been joking about with what's been going on in the U.S. that it's probably safer to go to Pakistan and hang out there for a while.
that's probably not far from the truth right now.
Yeah.
So let's wrap up. So thanks so much for talking about your Everest season and the Nepal season, the fundraiser, how you're trying to help the people over there, especially with the vaccinations. Anything else you want to add, Mark?
No, I think, it's great talking to you. And I think, I hope that everybody gets through this. We got just a few more months to get through this. And I think hopefully things will be getting back to normal soon.
Thanks.
Looking forward to that.
Yeah, you bet, man. Thanks so much for your time today, and best of luck to all the Mountain Madness family around the world for a safe and successful 2021.
Great. Thank you, Alan.
All right. Good climb on.
All right. Bye-bye.